I'm still, well, I'm going to try to talk loud so everyone can hear me. But my name's Andrew Unger. I'm the one of the event managers here at the Kepler Literary Foundation. And we're a nonprofit partner to Kepler's, and we do about 200 events a year here in the store, out in the community, and in schools around town. So I don't want to take up too much of your time, but Angie's going to be back here for Evenings in Deeps coming up with Jane Mayer on April 3rd. That's Monday, April 3rd. Angie Cuero's talking to Jane Mayer, who wrote the book Dark Money. So that's going to be an incredible evening. And then she's talking to a woman named Elizabeth Rosenthal on Wednesday, April 19th. That event is about healthcare. Elizabeth Rosenthal is a senior writer for the New York Times, and she has covered healthcare for decades. And she's got this new book out about the American healthcare system that Angie's going to talk to her about. Tonight we're here with Keith Devlin. Angie's going to tell you some more about him, but Keith is NPR's math guy, and he's the author of the new book Finding Fibonacci. So please welcome Keith.
Mic on and get you all set. You're not union. Don't touch that. Just kidding. By the way, you're going to see when I ask Keith a question, occasionally I'll look away and start typing. I'm not rude. I'm talking to the producer, okay? So I just want you to know I was brought up right.
I'm a college professor. Students all have a
ignore you. Okay, she's going to turn you up. We're going to get a sound check on you. So what did you have for breakfast?
What's the old BBC question? You want to know what I've had for breakfast?
Yes.
Just in case I get into a bit of a fit and it becomes visible what I have for breakfast.
No, actually, we don't need to know now.
That's probably enough, actually.
It probably is.
Yes.
You okay, Miss Britt? All right,
okay. No, I never actually answered the question, so.
Quite all right. No one will know. Okay, here we go. From Kepler's Books in Menlo Park, California, I'm Angie Cuero, and this is In Deep, one full hour on one intriguing topic. It's a very good thing that Dr. Keith Devlin has very well-established credentials. Otherwise, you might be a little concerned to come across a guy who can go on for hours about a series of numbers and how they relate to something called the golden ratio, and further, how so many people are wrong about the golden ratio. You might think, what is wrong with this man? Fortunately, he's very well-credentialed. Keith Devlin has been NPR's go-to math guy for more than 20 years because of his knack for making the obscure understandable. He's co-founder and executive director of Stanford's Human Sciences and Technologies Advanced Research Institute, a co-founder of Stanford MediaX University Industry Research Partnership, and a senior researcher in the Center for the Study of Language and Information. He is also the author of a ridiculous number of books, both academic and for the general public. So that's why it's not alarming, but really interesting to hear him talk a bit obsessively about Leonardo Fibonacci. You math-inclined folks may have immediately thought about the Fibonacci sequence, or the golden ratio. If you did, Keith has some surprises for you. It doesn't matter if you haven't heard of either, because as NPR has said, Keith Devlin has a gift for explaining the cerebral stuff in normal words. In 2012, he published Man of Numbers, Fibonacci's Arithmetic Revolution. Turns out there was another book hidden in there, Finding Fibonacci, a quest to rediscover the forgotten mathematical genius who changed the world. It is lovely to have him here on In Deep. Welcome.
Nice to be with you again.
See, it's interesting to see an author go back to the well. I mean, you wrote a very good book establishing the importance of this guy, explaining to people why he was forgotten, and then you kind of went back and did this again, and in a sense, that book was about him, and this book is kind of about both of you.
Yes, yeah. The 2011-12 book was about a book written in 100, almost about 1,000 years earlier, 1202, Libra Abaci by Fibonacci. So that was the original book, 1202. 2011 was my book about a book, this one is a book about a book about a book. And of course, you can keep pulling that stint indefinitely, but I think it would get a little bit boring.
It's kind of like numbers for the golden ratio. It just goes on and on.
I get used to these number sequences go on forever, so that would be the Devlin sequence, books and books and books.
So when you said in the initial part of your book, and you said how critically important this man was, and my thought was, well, why don't we know anything about him? And it turned out he was the victim of the "so 5 minutes ago" syndrome, because when he had written his work, when people were learning mathematics from him in his immediate realm, he was famous.
Yes.
And then the printing press came along, and he became "so 5 minutes ago."
Absolutely.
So why did that happen to him?
Yeah, he's just a victim of technology. It happens to people in the radio, I'm told.
Yeah.
Maybe not. Actually, radio and TV were recognized, were sort of rescued, because it all comes over the internet now. So.
Yes. Yeah, in one form or another. Yeah. But why did his books not move into the print world? I mean, if they were so important and so critical to people's understanding, wouldn't you think once we know how to print, it's one of the first things people would print?
Well, the point is, they were so successful within a few decades of Liber Abaci coming out in 1202. Dozens and dozens, and then eventually hundreds, and probably by extrapolation, thousands of copies were written by hand. It was all copied. But there were many of these things. Each time it was copied, it would be updated to the latest currencies, the latest exchange rates. So by the time the printing press came along, the ones that were actually put in print were the most recent ones. Well, that was over 250 years later. No one was going to go back to the first one that started it. They would copy the most recent ones, the most up-to-date. So the material that Liber Abaci explained, all the stuff that was in there, that material was actually printed within a few decades, a couple of decades of the printing press. So the material was used. But by then it was many generations since the original. No one was going to, and the original was in Latin. Mm-hmm. All of these others were in vernacular Italian. So there was just no need to go back. He was forgotten. And the only reason we know about him is he was a very famous mathematician at the time of the printing press, Luca Pacioli. And he wrote, very famous mathematician, he wrote a very scholarly version of the original Leonardo book. And in the beginning of that book, he says, everything in here comes from this guy, Leonardo of Pisa. And in the 19th century, a historian is going through, a mathematician who was interested in history, was going through the works of Luca Pacioli, sees this work that's famous and said, wait a minute, this is Luca Pacioli, a famous guy, this is his book, but he says it's not his work. He's just getting it from Leonardo. Who's this Leonardo? So this guy, Casali, they called him, this historian, he goes and looks around, he digs around, then he uncovers this thing. This was a guy in the 13th century who wrote not one, but a half a dozen books, was famous throughout Italy, was celebrated in Pisa, was made an honorary citizen of Pisa. He was a big shot. He was a friend of the emperor at the time. And yet he was forgotten because technology just took him away, took away all of the history and just produced the work. But thanks to Casali, and in a sense, by derivative, thanks to Pacioli, the thread was kept. But literally the thread between Leonardo then and what we know now was that one reference in a preface of one book that was printed. It was that close to extinction.
It makes you wonder what else we've lost.
Yes, it
doesn't
does.
It?
Yeah. This was my first serious book at history. When I was at school, I thought history was boring. I was the kid that thought math was fun and everything else was boring. So I've never done a real history book before. So this was, in fact, the only reason we have this new book is I was so new to the game. Excuse me. I decided I'd keep a sort of a record of it. Not least because I wasn't sure when I got into this what was important and what wasn't. When I read a maths article, I have a good sense for what's important, what's not. It was history. I didn't know what was going to be relevant or not. I kept a record of everything, took lots of photographs, had a whole record of the thing. And it was only after The Man of Numbers was finished, there was this mammoth pile of notes and stuff. I said, there's a story here. Another story. In this, it was a personal story of what happens when a mathematician says, I'm going to write a history book, not knowing what you're going to do. And I actually ploughed my way through it. And then it actually took 4 or 5 years to turn all of those notes into Finding Fibonacci. I got a lot of help from my agent, Ted Weinstein, and even more help when we took it to Princeton University Press. If it hadn't been for the efforts of Vicky Kern, my editor at Princeton University Press, this would not have been a book. It would have just been a collection of notes. It took a lot of work. It took me a lot of work because I'd never written that kind of book.
Mm-hmm.
This was the
memoir
one.
Memoir is very different from math.
I remember when I sent this book to Ted, my agent, and he's handled my books for many years, and I said, basically, be gentle with me on this one. This is the one book I've written where I am terrified about how people are going to regard it, because it was me in there. This wasn't me third person telling a story. This was me telling about my experiences, my reactions, my emotional responses to this thing. I was exposing myself in a way I'd never done before.
Yeah.
And I felt very nervous about that. And in the end, what happened was Vicky said, that's what we're going to play up. That's what makes it a story. She said, don't try to pull yourself down. Bring yourself out and just let the person know, this is, you know, I'm just going to give this a shot.
Right.
This is a mathematician trying to write history.
And it's kind of delicious because the things that you find in the first book about, for example, a statue of Fibonacci.
Yeah.
And then in your book, we discovered that in your quest to find this statue, you come across this woman in Pisa, who theoretically is there to help the tourists find things.
Oh, yes.
And she keeps correcting you, saying Leonardo da Vinci, and you're like, no, Leonardo Pisa.
One thing that did come out of the of all of those notes was I kept a record of all of these little cutesy stories, because I thought, if the book ever gets published, you know, or if anything comes out, the original book, the Man of Numbers, when I go on my author tour, I'll have all these little stories I can tell about writing the book. But there were so many of those little stories that it was really a book on its own. And so there's lots of little tales in finding Fibonacci.
Back to Fibonacci himself, the three things we think we know about him, we don't. That's not his real name. That's
correct.
Not the name he was born of.
Yeah.
The Fibonacci sequence he didn't discover. He wrote it and illustrated, but he didn't discover that. And when we get to the golden ratio, explaining what that is, that's not what we think it is either. So can we take those in pieces? What's the guy's name?
So the guy they didn't have surnames back then. He was called Leonardo. That's all he would have been called. Because he became famous in his lifetime, when he was older, he would have been allowed to call himself, and did call himself, Leonardo of Pisa, Leonardo Pisano. So he was Leonardo of Pisa. His father was called William, and his father was, there was a sort of family name called Bonacci, which was a sort of attached to them, so it wasn't really a surname, but they were the Bonaccis. It sounds like some bad guys in a mafia movie or something, but actually Fibonacci was the bad guy in some movie or other, some TV series. I forget what it was now anyway. Prison Break.
Right.
Yeah. I misspent part of my life too. So.
You want a Kleenex? We can grab one.
Hmm?
You want a Kleenex?
No, it's for
okay.
Okay.
This is what you hear that nobody else does.
Okay. So where were we? I just lost the track.
We're talking about his name. Fibonacci.
Yeah. So his father was of the Bonacci family. So when Leonardo writes his first book, the Libro Abaci in 1202, at least when he writes the reversion at the end of his career in 1228, we actually don't know what's in the original one. Except whatever it was, it made him famous very quickly. So famous that by the end of his career in 1228, the emperor said, you need to write a second version of this, expand it, make it longer. So the only information we've got is the copies of the 1228 edition. In the 1228 edition, he does something unusual, which was almost never done with medieval books. He writes a fairly lengthy introduction about himself, about his process in writing the book. I got the idea from him. I stole it. Right? So I wrote a whole book. But he writes this introduction. In other words, he puts details of himself. The only reason he would have done that is by then he knew that this was the big deal. This was change the world stuff. And he'd seen it change the world in his lifetime. Because in his lifetime, coming out of that part of the world, Pisa, Florence, that area, we have banking, we have insurance, we have double entry bookkeeping, we have international trading empires. It all came out within three or four decades of Libro Abaci, because everything was ripe. All it needed, the spark you needed to start the modern financial and commercial revolution, was an effective way of doing arithmetic at scale, and that was Hindu-Arabic arithmetic, which wasn't known in Europe until his book came out. So in the introduction to that book, in the second edition, he says, this is the book, the book of calculation. We translate Libro Abaci as the book of calculation. It's Abaci with two B's. It's not about the abacus, it's about throwing the abacus away and doing it with numerals and piece of paper and pencil. So he introduced it. This is a book of calculation written by Filius Bonacci. This is in the Latin. Filius Bonacci, literally son of Bonacci. Really, it means the Bonacci family. I'm in the Bonacci family. That phrase, Filius Bonacci, in the 19th century, after Leonardo had been rediscovered by this historian Casali, what happened then was that, well, a bunch of things happened, who was it? I think it was Casali himself. No, it was Libri. A guy called Guillaume Libri, another historian, comes along and gives Fibonacci, I mean, gives Leonardo this name Fibonacci. So Phidias Bonacci becomes Fibonacci. And the reason the historian does that, because he's writing in the 19th century, you need a name, and you certainly don't want people to think it's Leonardo da Pisa, da Vinci. So he gives him this name, Leonardo Fibonacci. So then he's got a name, surname, but it's a 19th century surname. And it was not long after that that another mathematician, Edward Luca, said, oh, one of the hundreds of exercises in Libra Abaci is this silly little problem about pigeon populations that gives you this sequence of numbers 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 22, etc., the Fibonacci sequence. Until then, it was just some sequence that people writing arithmetic books always put in because it's a good way of practicing Hindu arithmetic. The problem itself goes back to the Hindu mathematicians who invented Hindu arithmetic in the first few centuries of the current era. But Edward Lucas says, well, it's an interesting service. It's a cute little math service. We'll give it a name. And since it was in Libra Abaci, since it was in Libra Abaci, we'll just call it the Fibonacci sequence. That's the only connection. Other than mentioning it in his book, there's no indication that Leonardo was interested in it, knew that it was an interesting thing. It was just a problem he copied and reproduced.
And he liked to tell little stories. He was introducing the concept of mathematics not to intellectuals, but to common people,
yes,
to help them to do their business. And it was one of his little stories he threw in there. You know? And one thing I liked about your book is you go into these other tales that he puts in.
Yeah.
And it's common sense problems or common sense situations. Some of them from a strictly practical point of view, others to kind of wake people up saying, you're still with me.
Yeah.
So are any of those you care to share, any of those little stories he threw in?
Some of them are quite well known. There's the one about the, sometimes it's a lion, sometimes it's another creature in a pit, and you say, you know, the lion can go up three steps and then slides down two at night. How many nights before it gets out of it? Then you have to, the trick is you have to realize that the last time it doesn't slide down because it's got up the top. But it's those kind of cute little problems that you find in there. And there's roughly what he does is, he literally is trying to change the world. I mean, so he's, all of his problems, and this is a huge manuscript. I actually have held two of the 13th century manuscripts in my hand, which is an awesome thing to do. So these are big piles of parchment. Almost everything about them is example after example after example. This is one of the world's most boring books unless you think about how it came to be written. It's like reading computer code.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a reasonable analogy because he's basically recoding the Western world. He's giving it the method for doing all of this stuff. But it's just one after another example, because he knows that, and he was clearly a gifted teacher, he knows that people are going to be reading this book without any help. You can't go to anybody else because nobody's seen this stuff before. This is the first thing, there's no context for it. So he knows that he's got to have many, many examples. And the examples about changing currencies, about weights and measures, all sort of dull examples. But the idea being, any tradesperson who's setting up in business simply has to leaf through and find a similar problem and says, this is my problem, I'll change the numbers to my numbers and I'll crank through the thing. They're all worked examples. So that's the start of the thing. But he knows that even someone who wants to learn is going to get bored by this. So every now and then he throws one of these cute little ones. You know, so
who can resist
laughing.
Bunnies? He puts bunnies in
there.
Yeah,
these funky little things. Yeah. And so he does these all the time. And it's just classic. And, you know, those of us that teach mathematics, we do the same thing. When we notice the students getting a bit bored, we throw in a funky little language. Just some funky little cute example. We do it all the time.
Let's touch on the golden ratio, which is an idea of how angles relate to each other, and if you look at it correctly, you'll find the pattern of the Nautilus and the pattern of a penstemon and the ideal, you know, facial beauty. So let's shoot that up and down. First, with your gift for explaining things, the golden ratio is?
So you take an interval and you put a line in the middle of it. And you put that line in, that you're splitting an interval into two in such a way that the ratio of the whole to the longest part equals the ratio of the longest part to the shortest part. And if you put that, that's basically, it's x to 1 minus x equals, you can turn it into algebra, you get a quadratic equation when you cross multiply. And if you solve it, you get one of the roots is about 1.6. Okay, it's an irrational number, just bigger than 1.5. So it's been around a long time. And it goes back to Euclid's Elements. It was just an exercise in geometry about where can you, at what point do you divide the line so that the ratio of the whole to the part is the ratio of the large to the small? And Euclid called it the extreme something
mean.
Ratio.
Mean something, wasn't it? Was that
mean and I forget it, because it doesn't really matter what it is. It's some phrase, but not a sexy phrase. It was just a simple exercise in solving quadratic equations in the days when that was a big deal. Okay, so that's Euclid. Unfortunately, at around the time of Leonardo da Vinci and that sort of time, someone mischievously decided to call it the divine ratio. Well, that's asking for trouble. And somebody else called it the golden ratio. So now you've got God and wealth connected with this number. This thing was going to get a life of its own. And sure enough, in the 19th century, a guy who's desperate to sell popular books invents about 15 properties of the golden ratio with no evidence whatsoever, and it becomes a bestseller, and then people start copying it. So since the late 19th century, we've had all of these stories about the golden ratio. It's in the Parthenon, it's in music, it's in Yardi, and it's nonsense. I mean, if we weren't recording, I'd use the word I'd like to use. It begins with a C, but anyway, or there's another one with B, but either way, it's just made up. There's no historical reference. One of the things they say is that the most pleasing rectangle has the aspect ratio of the golden ratio. Complete nonsense. First of all, you can run studies. Most people don't think it's the most pleasing one. Secondly, there
is
no
pleasing rectangle.
Thing.
So
as I say, you give something the names divine and golden, and people will believe anything. It's just the way the world is. But it's all nonsense. The one thing there, the golden ratio, does mean something is in nature. Human beings and their aesthetics and dentists and various people that claim there's a golden ratio, that's spurious. I mean, you can make money doing that, you can sell stocks and so forth by doing that. But the one place that you will find the golden ratio is in nature, because nature loves the golden ratio. It's the ratio where things happen optimally in terms of natural selection. So there's good scientific reasons for the golden ratio being an important number. It is an important number. It's connected to the Fibonacci sequence, because if you take the ratios of Fibonacci numbers up the sequence, the further out you go, they get closer and closer to the golden ratio. And the reason you find Fibonacci numbers in nature, in numbers of petals on flowers, numbers of leaves on plants, and spirals in pine cones, and spirals in pineapples and so forth, is that because growing things sort of are attracted to the golden ratio to get more sunlight, to get more nutrients.
The way the leaves spiral, yes, yeah.
They all spiral, sunflower seeds and things. So when you look at the mathematics of growth, you find the golden ratio is where things happen optimally, and nature optimizes with natural selection. But because you can only have a whole number, the golden ratio is 1.6 something something, 618 something, because, and it's an irrational number, because you can only have, it's a fractional thing, what you want in terms of leaves and things is their whole numbers. So the number of leaves, the number of spirals, are the integers which approximate towards the golden ratio. And those are the Fibonacci numbers. So the reason you found the Fibonacci numbers in nature is those are the, when you round the golden ratio down, to get, they weren't actual. I actually was asked by, I think it was Discover magazine, asked me to do a review. I try not to trash things. I think his book sold an awful lot more copies than I did. It's a rollicking story. But the mathematics was wrong. I mean, he just copied the stuff and repeated the stuff, as people do. I have to admit, for the first 10 years of my career, it was such a great story. I'm a young lecturer in England, and I want to get my students excited. I repeated them as well, until one day I got it wasn't an email, it was a letter from someone who said, you might want to check the literature on this thing. This is not true. Absolutely right. There's a lot of scholarship on this thing. There was a book written by Mario Livio, who's actually, I think, an astronomer in one of the astronomy places on the East Coast, called Phi, The Story of Nature's Most Astonishing Number or something. Livio's book is really good because one by one, he goes through and gives the scholarship and says, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong. Everything falls except the stuff to do with that you find in the garden. If it's in the garden, it's probably true for reasons we understand. If it's in the other example, it's almost certainly false, and we can trace it back to this 19th century guy who was trying to make money selling popular books. And I have sympathy for people trying to sell books, but you might as well make it true.
In fact, I want to point our listeners to, there's a marvelous, it's an hour and a half, an hour and 40 minutes explanation of this that you did. It's a great presentation. It's online at YouTube. And right next to that, you'll find all the other YouTube videos that are wrong about everything that's in there.
That's from the Museum of Mathematics, isn't it?
Yeah.
That is their most popular video in terms of comments. And the reason is those are virulent comments. They've never had someone give a talk at the Museum of Mathematics who's got so much invective in the comments. They think it's wonderful because it puts them up in the rankings. I was tempted to read them, and I got to the third one and I thought, no, I can't read another seven.
Yeah, I didn't even look at the comments. Yeah. There's no way.
So, on the principle that there's no such thing as bad publicity, the Museum of Mathematics chalks that up as a success. But it's interesting that people get so irate.
Yeah. Watch the video, skip the comments. Yeah. Another question from the audience. Because the Fibonacci numbers so often appear in nature, as you said, and are so central to the so-called sacred geometry, can you reflect on the spiritual meaning of the numbers, or is there any?
I don't think well. When I start talking about the nature of mathematics, to anybody else, I'm getting spiritual. And in a sense, that's quite reasonable, because I'm part of that world. So in the sense that the numbers have an elegance and certain various kinds of symmetry to them, they have all sorts of connections to the real world. So whenever I really start to wax lyrical, then I'm definitely in a spiritual realm. But remember, mathematicians use the word the infinite all the time, in a spiritual sense, but it's not what other people mean when they talk about the infinite and so forth. So in the sense of organized religions or various kinds of beliefs, that's not me. When I start talking about mathematics, many people have said that sounds spiritual, and I take that as a compliment.
Well, I can see that. There's a moment in the book where, you've been pursuing a manuscript for so long,
Yeah. And
you find it accessible to mere human beings. I mean, it's not like it's behind layers of metal and glass. You're able to hold this in your hands, and frankly, your passion for it was transparent.
Yeah.
It really
that
is.
Was, and that, that, yeah, if you read the book, it took me many attempts. This was Italy, in Italy, everything's cute. Or there's a vacation, or someone else. So it took many attempts to actually get hold of this thing. The weird thing is, and this was one of the three good manuscripts of Libro Bacci, is in the public library in Siena. Now that's the public library. This is it's a 13th century manuscript, probably written either in Leonardo's time or shortly after he died. One direct copy, maybe, almost certainly. A big pile of manuscript. It is bound, but it's in there. It's got a public library reference number. Any person from the public can go and consult it. You can't borrow it, but you can read it there. All you had to do, I had to leave my passport with them. When I finally did find it open and they had it in stock there, they brought it out, put it at a table, and said, "There you go." And I'm sitting there suddenly, and this was an incredible moment in my life. There is this thing, manuscript from the 13th century. And by then, I'd done a lot of research, because it took me several attempts to get to see this, a couple of trips to Italy before I saw it. By then, this had become a big thing in my life. I've been going after this thing. And there it is. And I'm thinking to myself, this is one of the books that gave rise to the world I live in, and we've all lived in. This was it. It's like looking at Steve Wozniak's first version of the Apple II or the Macintosh. I mean, this was something that changed the world. It was just phenomenal. And I was at one of the original ones. And I'm thinking, there's probably only a few people have held this since the 13th century, because for most of the time this wasn't even consulted. It's only recently people started looking at this. You've got that connection back 800 years in time. You're holding the same paper that someone wrote and consulted. And I'm thinking to myself, Galileo may have held this very manuscript and studied it, because it was in Pisa. I'm just thinking, that kind of connection to history is phenomenal. And there's no way you're going to give me a thumb drive and I'm going to get excited. But I got excited about that. And you can smell it, you can feel it.
Just tangentially, on the one hand, I was thrilled that you were able to hold it and touch it. On the other hand, I'm thinking, this thing's got to be fragile. You've got finger oils. It's open to oxygen. Don't they worry about that?
They may do now. This was back in about 2002, 2003. They didn't even check to see if my hands were clean. It was absolutely staggering. I walked in, I had cameras, and I could see that they didn't want me to take photographs, and that was fine. No flash photography. But I took pens, I took a notepad, I took a ruler. And I'm actually just sitting there, and there's the desk there, and about 10 paces away, there's the door to the street outside. And I'm sitting holding this thing that's essentially priceless, and I'm thinking, I could scribble on this, I could sign Gilroy was here or some stuff. I could draw little things. I could have done anything. And I was aware of that at the time. I was staggered that there was no security like that. There's a little bit more security at the Florence National Library in Florence. That one was a little bit more secure. I actually had to get an archive card from the Italian library. I had to become a registered access to the archives. The only other good copy of Libro Abaci, the good copy, is in the Vatican Library, and unfortunately the archives were closed when I was doing the research, so I've never seen that one. Florence took me a bit longer to get in, but once I was in, same thing. The book was handed to me. Spend as long as you want, turn the pages. I grew up in England at the time when we had to learn Latin, so I was able to read the Latin. It wasn't just holding it, I was able to read this thing. It was awesome. And that degree of connection to the past is just... I remember once talking to Stephen Robinson, one of the shuttle astronauts, who's a friend of mine, or sort of friend, after he went up twice, he was in the John Glenn trip. And I actually asked him the question I'm sure he's been asked a lot. I said, was your life after your first space flight different? Absolutely, it was different. Life was never the same again. For me, holding Leonardo's book manuscripts, it was the same. There was pre-manuscript and post-manuscript. Never the same again.
You're listening to Dr. Keith Devlin. If you're just tuning in, this is In Deep, and I'm Angie Claro. I got a couple quick hit questions for you. And after that, we're going to move into some other areas. Can you speak about Leonardo da Pisa's role in introducing Base 10 to the West?
That was really what it was all about. It was the Hindu-Arabic numerals. Well, the Hindu-Arabic numerals did already come into Italy. They'd come in from various ways. They came in from Spain. So from about the 9th century, they were already floating around. But they were just symbols. I mean, they were just sort of cute things you could put on. Well, they didn't have T-shirts, but it would have been T-shirts. I mean, they were just funky things you put on the wall and things like symbols. So those were around, but what wasn't around were the methods for computing with them, the methods of arithmetic, you know, units column, tens column. That was unknown. When people had to do arithmetic before that book appeared, they either used an abacus board, a board with rules on it where you would move pebbles around, or they had a finger counting system that was good for numbers up to 10,000. Now, in both of those cases, there was a lot of dexterity and practice required, so most people paid somebody else to do it. The nice thing about Hindu-Arabic arithmetic is, or one of the nice things is, you have to learn a few simple rules for how to write and do the computation. But after that, you've mastered it, because you can teach it to a five-year-old, and we've been doing that ever since. So it takes all of the effort out of it, other than learning some simple manipulations. So it's a very simple system. It's democratizing, because anyone can set up in business. You don't have to hire someone to keep your books. You can do it yourself. You see, this was the world's first personal computing revolution. It allowed people to do their own computing, set up in business. And so it was the introduction of that in the beginning of the 13th century, that method that was the spark that started the commercial revolution.
One of our audience members wants to know, before Fibonacci, did Europe really use Roman numerals, and what were the limitations of that?
Not only did they use them, but even after Libro Abaci came out, the Florence bookkeepers had a law passed that said you cannot record your financial transactions except in Roman numerals, because they were about to go out of business. This was one of the first cases. It's like Uber and Lyft and taxis and things. They were going to lose business, and they lost out very quickly. But yeah, you had to use Roman numerals. It was very inefficient, because you calculated in one way and you recorded in a different way. Roman numerals make addition and subtraction trivial, multiplication and division really difficult, but unfortunately, business mathematics is all about multiplication and division. It's about changing currencies, weights and measures and things. So what Hindu-Arabic arithmetic did was it provided a method which was not only good for calculation by anybody, even children, but it also kept its own record. It was its own bookkeeping, and it was also an audit trail, because there's the whole calculation. One action does everything. That was echoed in modern computers, of course.
Oh, and you've been making the parallels to the modern stuff. You mentioned Steve Jobs earlier. It's a fascinating I don't know if you'd call them parallel stories that you put together, and this will change the world. Parallel lines, and on the left side of the page, you're talking about in Palo Alto, December 79,
yeah.
And then you're starting out with what's happening in North Africa in 1190. So obviously can't do the whole thing,
no,
but where are you seeing those parallels?
Okay, yeah, so this was bizarre, because I was going over to Italy every year, sometimes twice a year. So I've got Silicon Valley here, I'm getting on a plane, I'm getting off in Pisa and Siena, and I'm finding out about this story, and I'm thinking, this is Steve Jobs going to Xerox PARC, seeing this cool new way of doing computing, and realizing that you could change the world doing that. So when I had done the research, I got out my old battered copy of Stephen Levy's book, Insanely Great, about the invention of the Macintosh, and I read through it, and every time I saw Steve Jobs, I said, can I put Fibonacci in there? Every time I saw the Macintosh, can I put Libra Abaci there? And I got through the whole book. It was the same story. Not just paragraph, not just page by page or chapter by chapter, almost paragraph by paragraph. So indeed, in this book, I have this parallel development where on one side, there's Stephen Levy's explanation of the Macintosh, and then there's how it also applies to this thing. Even to the details that Steve Jobs sees this thing, builds the Lisa, it works, but it's going to cost $30,000 and it's too difficult. So the Macintosh is a slimmed down, simplified version of the Lisa. Leonardo writes Libra Abaci. That's big. It's in Latin. No one's going to read it. So he writes a smaller version, cheaper, simpler. He writes Arithmetic for Dummies. That's the one that took off. That's the Macintosh. So for the same reason, he's established the principle in Libra Abaci. He says, now I need to slim it down and make it marketable. So Leonardo knows how to market. That's why he changed the world. He didn't invent it any more than Steve Jobs invented the Macintosh. You know, he got that from Xerox PARC and SRI. So that was just a copy. What Steve Jobs' brilliance was knowing how to package it so it will sell itself. Leonardo did the same. How do you package Hindu arithmetic so it will sell itself? He did it, and it worked.
I love this question. It sounds like the golden ratio examples are basically fake news.
You bet.
Are there other fake news numbers in mathematics?
Oh, lots of them. Let's not go. Actually, maybe at some point I'll write a book. Ooh, this is a good idea. Fake news in mathematics.
You'll get credit.
Keep, follow me on Twitter. I'll let you know when that one comes out. There's a lot of stuff in math. It's kind of weird that people have two views of mathematics. They say, I don't like mathematics, I don't like numbers. And yet everyone's a numerologist. Everyone seems fascinated by the fact that there are hidden numbers in things, hidden numbers in the Bible, hidden numbers in the Constitution. They have all this fascination with mathematics. You've got to ask yourself, why are people fascinated by numbers? Because even if consciously they don't think they like it, it's in our psyches that our world was built on numbers 8,000 years ago. When numbers were invented about 8,000 years ago in Sumeria, that changed the world. Because just try to imagine anything in life from the moment you wake up without numbers. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't even know when you wake up. You look at the clock. Numbers are with us. Life without numbers and life with numbers are hugely different. And somehow in our psyche, there's a recollection of that. We know that numbers are important. They know that we depend on them. So even people who say they're not numbers people seem to have that fascination, which I think is why they get up at me when I say they go, their favorite number, the golden ratio, it's spurious. It's almost a religious belief I'm attacking now.
But you know, the other thing that you think about is there were people who existed before we understood arithmetic and mathematics.
Yeah.
They're the ones that are hard to fathom for me. I can't imagine not knowing what time it is or not knowing, you know, how many berries are in that basket. There was the way brains work before numbers.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, one of the difficult things about writing this book, and no one had written an extensive history of Leonardo because there was nothing known about him, except that one paragraph he wrote at the beginning of the Libra Abaci. So historians of mathematics and science had never tackled him. The only reason I felt I could tackle him was I said, look, we don't know any facts about his life, but he's left behind five or six huge books. Well, two of them were huge, and the others were sort of substantial. So we have a lot of writing. A historian can't look at that writing and glean much because it's mathematics, but I'm a mathematician. When I read mathematics, it's like a musician looking at sheet music. I can see things in my mind, like it comes to life. So by reading Leonardo's works, his mathematical works, I can get a sense of him, at least as a mathematician. and that's what he's famous for anyway. So I can get an access to, you know, I don't know about his sex life or what kind of things he did or any of that kind of stuff, which means I can't sell my book the usual ways, but I can get an insight into it. So the way I wrote the book was, I said, I'm going to recreate him in my mind by doing two things. Reading his own words, thousands of them, and going to Italy, to these medieval cities. Pisa is almost identical, large parts of Pisa are just the same as they were in his day. The Leaning Tower has been built when he was alive. The customs house where his father lived, it still exists, there's a photograph in the book. So you're able to walk around Pisa and get a sense of what it was like then, because it looks the same. You just ignore the scooters and the cars and the pollution. But you get a feeling for the place, you have the person's words. And then eventually I looked at the statue when I found it and had an image. So I was able to recreate Leonardo. Is it the real Leonardo? Well, not in a sense, no. But then history never recreates the real thing. It recreated in a perception. The version of Leonardo I was able to create in my mind is the important one. It's the version of him through his mathematics. And that's what changed the world.
Can I express my sympathy and admiration for how many trips to Italy you must have suffered from the all those
cappuccinos, all that spaghetti, all those pizzas. I'm a keen cyclist, so you know, what can I do after a morning in the archives? I get on my bike and ride up through the hills of Tuscany. Oh, it was unbelievable.
You make it worse.
And you know, the cute thing is, it was all tax deductible. If they come at me, they can have a copy of the book.
Well, I think someone is really summarizing the whole thing for us here, with Fibonacci's contributions having been overshadowed, possibly unfairly, by the sequence. Should that be rectified, our guest asked. And that's kind of where the book is. That's kind of what your two books are doing with him, is putting him in his proper place.
Yeah. It was, originally I was just keeping a record sort of so I could go on the book tours and that kind of thing for the Man of Numbers. But it is an interesting story, not least because it turned out I wasn't the only person who was going at Leonardo. I was going at Leonardo from the perspective of a mathematician, and I'd followed in his footsteps. Now, the reason I was interested in him in the first place is I've spent a lot of my life trying to write books that people could read. So I've been following in Leonardo's footsteps. So in a sense, you know, I felt I owed him that sense of sort of, I was getting down on my knees and worshipping, if you like. Actually, your review has already mentioned that that thing's going to come there. So that was really the reason why I got involved with him, was just this sense of him. But I'm getting close to things. If I say things a certain way, it's going to come across as sort of, it's kind of weird. I can't think of the words that aren't going to cross weird, so I'll circle back to that in a minute. Yeah.
Well, in fact, you had said that there were several parallel journeys going on. There was a really, and I can't find the name right now, there was a really touching story about the man who was trying to translate the book, and he died before it was finished, and his wife finished it.
So, in fact, that was one case. The other story was a professor of mathematics at Bucknell who got interested in Leonardo. It's more or less the same reasons I did. Just got interested in the person, and he set out to translate Leonardo's works. He translated one of them, the shorter one, and then he started work on translating Liber Abaci. But then he got terminal cancer, and he was racing against his imminent death to finish the book. He finished the book. Was about to send it off to the pub. Actually, did send it off to the publisher on floppy disks, and then he died. And then there was all sorts of problems with the publisher and losing one of the disks and everything. And then his widow decided she would publish it on his behalf. Now she was a Hungarian from Hungary. She had been an engineer, but she was working in the U.S. She was married to this guy, and she basically said she was going to finish off the process. That took an enormous amount of work. It was several years, with the help of some of the mathematicians at Bucknell, she eventually was able to get this translation into modern form. She had to teach herself Don Knuth's method of tech. This had to be typeset in tech for the books. Tech, T-E-X, tech. It's a way of typesetting books yourself. You have to learn how to type. If you're a mathematician, you have to learn how to typeset manuscripts. So she taught herself this programming language to turn her dead husband's manuscript into a book. Most of the discs had been damaged. She had to recreate a lot from his notes. She essentially taught herself the mathematics the typesetting instructions for LaTeX and tech in order to produce this book. And moreover, she did it all the time pretending to be her dead husband, because the contract was to her husband. She wanted to make sure that book appeared. She didn't want to say, I'm going to finish it, because the contract would have been null and void. She used his email address. She acted as him until the book was about to be published. And then she said, well, actually, you're not dealing with this guy. My husband's dead. You're dealing with me, and you have been for the last 5 or 6 years. But she did that to get it out. This was one of several stories of this. I said, I wasn't the only person. Another person was a professor of finance at Yale. The last chapter, or the, almost the last chapter in my book, I didn't actually write it. Because this famous finance professor at Yale went into Libra Abaci and said, it wasn't just arithmetic in there. You can find all of the modern financial instruments in there. You want to know where derivatives began? Go and look in Libra Abaci.
It's his fault.
Yeah.
We've got to take a break here.
It all goes in there. It's a fascinating one of these many stories.
In our next segment, we're going to leave Fibonacci behind and talk about how one goes about learning math, arithmetic, etc. And that goes into some political issues in the classroom as well. A lot more to talk about with Keith Devlin. Stick around. I'm Angie Carter. This is In Deep.